thank you, Adam and Filmforum, for bringing me here and bringing all these films together to screen. I'm really excited to share them with you and so happy to see some new faces. So I'll say that Malibran has joined us for this. She's come from Los Angeles. These three films, desert films, the first one I started a while ago with being someone at the gas station nearby and seeing him at the next day and decided to make a film about Castaic Lake, which is a reservoir on the California aqueduct right above, at the edge of Los Angeles County, and supplies water for Western Los Angeles and power and recreation of all kinds. So that's, while the first is a portrait of a person in this specific place, the second is the portrait of the space, roving around the space through me or the camera. And then through the first film, I ended up going to this place called the Calico Early Man site and meeting Ren there, and she was this other sort of vehicle of understanding the desert and a whole different relationship to the desert. So I decided to spend a few years following her and having her as my guide to the whole kind of Mojave region. So that's it, thanks.
Delighted to have with us as well, Ren Lalitha.
Thank you.
Wow. Let's see, we'll perch here in the corner. So those were really beautiful films. I thought I'd start with a couple of questions, and then of course we'll see if all of you have as well, and if a couple are related to the other films as well. I'm sure we'll mostly talk about the third as well. One thing that seemed really important to me in these three was this relationship between, say, geologic time, human time, and film time. Mm-hmm. And in a dialogue sort of going on between, say, the immensity of geologic time and the brevity of human time. And I'm curious as to if Brigid, first you might reflect upon that, if that was a relevant thing, how that was relevant for you perhaps in your approach to the films and so forth.
Yeah, certainly difficult to summarize, but I mean, starting with Castaic Lake, I mean, that, you know, that's 30 years young and, you know, shaping very much this relationship to nature through all these activities, both, you know, power, water, and recreation, and, you know, being out in nature as needing a sort of vehicle to do that, whether it's fishing or boating. And, you know, not that those things are very enjoyable sometimes, but it's a sort of specific kind of container, and that is very young and controlled. You know, the dam sort of covered up a huge canyon, and all of that geologic space is kind of latent and buried in the presence of all the activity that's taking place on the surface. So yeah, I think after making that, when I met Ren and wanting to spend more time in the Mojave and kind of see the space through geologic time and her being kind of an access point to doing that, and that's sort of how the film was guided, just by her talking about various geologic kind of locations and eras of time, and from 14 million years old to almost 2 billion years old, and kind of finding those spaces and
why was it important to you to include in each film, then, I mean, at least one element of this, of a human reflecting upon something about, you know, mortality in some way?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, was that? If there is a way to answer that.
It's hard to summarize. I mean, it seems sort of like inevitably intertwined, I guess, with...
Humans being finite and time limited.
Yeah, and I guess how we understand that through, you know, these other layers of time, and, you know, our human body, our form being finite as well, and sort of how, you know, it can be buried or disintegrate or merge with the land.
Ren, I mean, for me, it's like you're very generous with yourself in giving us this possibility of, you know, I would say revealing portrait. And I was curious, like, how did you come to, like, first, from your side, how did you first meet Brigid? And then how did you come to accept being willing to have her film you?
Well, yeah. this film is synthesized of what, 3-4 years of work that we did? So it was a long process, Adam. But I met Brigid up at the Calico Early Man site up there, and I was doing some geology consultation for him up there, but I was living in my vehicle, and I never wanted to consider myself homeless, even though by the overculture standards I was. But I just said I had a home. It was unconventional. And even if that meant just sleeping out in the rocks, that was my home, and I felt at home there. So Brigid and I just started to talk about some of that, and I guess she just locked onto me like a laser. And she started asking me, how are you doing this? And, you know, she wanted to learn from me. Well, see, that's where she hooked me. I'm a teacher and a talker. So she just pulled me right into it. And I always felt very comfortable and safe with Brigid. A lot of the reason I was out there is I was having a time away from humanity, actually, and just needed to take some time out from college and decide what I wanted to do when I grow up, I guess. So Brigid followed me all over, clear up to Washington State, because some part of the time I was snowbirding. The last couple of years, the heat was doing me in, and so she followed me clear up there, and we just formed this real collaborative, wonderful friendship, and learned a lot from each other, and so it was a long process, and just happened that way, Adam. You know, she's very persuasive when she wants to be. And she asks the questions. She's got such a gift for evoking the questions. I mean, sometimes she just rocked me with some of the questions she was asking, and I just go, oh, geez. You know, so it'd pull me into really looking at what my ideas are, or my opinions, or, you know, she's very gifted at evoking the important questions and drawing that out in her subjects. So, that's how it happened.
How did you involved, or how did you come to choose over 3 or 4 years of filming which were the essential things you needed to include? Like, how did snowboarding not make it in?
Not snowboarding, yeah. Snowboarding.
Snowboarding, yeah.
Snowboarding.
Yeah, that's going.
That's a little different.
Yeah, that's a lot different. Snowboarding. Let's see, snowbird. So you go up in there when it's so hot down here, you go north in high country, and then winter when it's cold and snowy up there, you come down here. It's a nomadic lifestyle.
It's sort of some ways simple, logistical, or and kind of what you've done before that you don't really want to do again, I guess. I mean, and I had made these sort of other portraits that were a little quicker and cutting up interview and, you know, non-synchronous image and sound, and I became interested, though, you know, coming from a film background, it's obvious to most people who shoot with video that it's sync sound, but I kind of wanted to explore doing these long, extended interviews over time and over a wide range of space. And, you know, when I first met her, I'd followed her up to Washington, thinking and trying to shoot some 60 millimeter there and just not being happy with it, and then she ended up moving back here, and so it just timing.
We'll start with everybody in the back.
We can't hear you. Loud.
I had a curious reaction as you were talking about the rocks being sentient, and then I realized a little later on that the whole Earth there is a character in that movie.
That is correct. That is correct. You got it. The Earth Mother Mojave, I call her, is one of the stars of our show. And it is a living relationship. That's how I relate to it, and that's how I teach at the university, classes, everything. I really believe that it's a participative universe. And so we all are in active energy flow, whatever you want to call it, in a living, dynamic, collaborative relationship. So that's my approach to it. I am Native American, so part of that comes from that kind of relationship with the Earth. But it's something that I operate on, but Brigid picked up on that too, and she resonates with that on some level. I'm not speaking for her, but she certainly understood me on that level, and so we went with it. And you're right, the Earth itself, even that's a thread through what Brigid does. The Earth is one of the characters and everything that she's doing there. Mm-hmm. So.
When you teach that, where do you find people are either more resistant to that notion or more accepting?
Some are very resistant. I work with that and try and give them evidence. And I really teach experientially, Adam. Evergreen. My evergreen buddies up here. You learn best by full body immersion. And it also depends on who the class is. I've taught a lot of college classes for Native Americans, and they're wide open to this. Matter of fact, they're so relieved to hear me say it. And this is how I start every lecture, every quarter. This is how we're going to go with this. And so, some people are very resistant to it, but I try to give them evidence and an experience of that living presence.
Please, anything on the filmmaking or on the experiences of it, please.
Brandeis, you're listening to the radio a lot and hearing other people's voices, and I was wondering whether you'd ever heard yourself recorded at such great length before this project.
It's an interesting thing, especially for all the years that we were doing this. She had hundreds of hours probably of stuff to sort through and edit and figure out what she wanted to do with it. Solitude is a very beautiful thing, and there's a big difference between solitude and loneliness. But there were times it was hard to take the loneliness. I'd call my friends back in Barstow or something and say, hey, it's time for me to be back with some two-legged creatures. Can I come back and hang out and take a shower, you know, and stuff. So. And maybe you're right. I hadn't really thought of that consciously. At night, there was nothing to do, and I wasn't always real sleepy, so I had this little AM/FM shortwave radio, and I'd listen to programs all over the world and stuff. And you're right. Maybe it's that human sound input, because the silences out there are just staggering. I mean, it's many times you can actually hear your heart beating and stuff. It's so silent.
And there's something about the radio out there, too, and you listen to it. It seems meant for you. When you're alone, it's sort of...
Yeah, and I could pick and choose on lots of programs that I like to listen to, and, you know, especially shortwave all over the world. And sit out there and listen to Radio Havana, Cuba, you know, or whatever I wanted to do. So it was companionship, yeah. It's really what it was. And, yeah.
Richard, for you, and well, I'll go back to Castaic for a moment. A couple of brief questions. One is, I'm sort of, like, drawing from this, though. I mean, you had very much, like, observations of the landscape for extended periods of time, and then certain like humans, these are the people you encounter. I was wondering like how you found the people who you ended up having in the film, and then how did you find like your structure for that film as well?
I mean, I just went there periodically over like 2 years, and I think when I first started going there, I imagined it was all going to be through people that I met more, and that they would be sort of these different guides to the space, because I think like the lifeguard was someone I met early on, and so I knew there were these people involved in kind of the work activity there, and then I thought there would be sort of other other guides, but it just wasn't actually an easy place I found to meet people, or that felt totally awkward or unnatural, which is still kind of there, I think, in some of those relationships that you can kind of see in passing. So, and some of those people, like, I spent a lot of more time with, and, you know, like the guy with his dogs, he, that was a long thing, and then it didn't work in the sort of balance of kind of showing the space, I guess, and showing the sort of layers of activity there.
So what sort of structure did you end up using or finding for the film?
Was it random people out in the public?
There's definitely a random factor. The structure was sort of guided over kind of showing the construction, the mass of the space, and then I think kind of breaking into these more sort of individual relationships that less about sort of architecture and more human experience and like attempts to kind of connect to it.
Where was it important for you to like convey, shall we say, just information in certain ways? I mean, not necessarily explicit, but like, you know, fish stocking or the aqueduct or whatnot, but to understand this is all part of it, even if it's not, you know, explained in an overt way in the film.
Uh-huh. Are you asking about,
how did you decide what were things that you should include, and then, like, what were the limits on how much information you wanted to provide?
I guess the question of what's information, because I think, you know, like the film with Ren is like there's all of this verbal explaining going on, and Kesig has kind of the text or their narration doesn't function as much as verbal explanation, but you have the explanation of space and activities. For me, that was Kesig, like, was that kind of looking at this one space and understanding this tension between those different kinds of, I guess, information development structure.
Anybody?
Yes.
First of all, beautiful films, love them. I'm just curious about the desert as your subject and.
Can you talk louder?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm curious about the desert as your subject, and because I know you're from the East Coast, and is there something about the desert itself that is sort of an ideal subject for you, or is it more incidental to living here now? Do you think you'd be making this kind of film elsewhere in the country? I was just trying to imagine you having scenes in Washington and having a really hard time imagining that, because... There seems to be something so bright about the desert, and I'm curious what
you're... I guess when I moved out here, I sort of felt resistant to making, like, desert films. I was like, oh, that's so obvious. And so, like, move to California and go out and make romantic films about the desert with amazing light, and I don't know.
You lived in the desert for a while, though, didn't you?
I did live in Tucson for a year, but I guess it's just, like, this... I feel compelled to spend time there, and I mean, filmmaking is ultimately a way to, for me, often spend time in a situation that you want to be in.
It's a good excuse to go out there.
Yeah. So, and then once I did that, just sort of one thing started connecting to another, and I think the kind of head space you can have out there and getting out of a city is like something.
You could have gotten connected instead to the beach or to Hollywood streets at night, and those would have been
that's
like
true.
Very different. please.
I'm curious, going back to the Castaic Lake, how you, I was really captured by your sound to image pairings.
Yeah.
And I was curious if there was a structure that you followed or what your, how you made your choices.
It just sort of came out through editing that I was trying to figure out how to structurally kind of show the space and all of these diverging areas and activities. And so one way to do that was to let like sound bleed from kind of one space to the other. So I think that's, yeah, that kind of, whether it's just kind of music being played through radio or these narrations or so just kind of thinking of it as like we cross weaving and that it could still be like a synchronous feeling in a way, but it wasn't, it's mentally kind of synchronous, but
yeah.
not actually synchronous.
Yeah. Yeah. Beautifully shot, all the films. But I had one question about the first one. Why the young man, was he working at a shop? He was at AMPM?
Yeah.
I was just wondering why you chose not to show him working.
That was sort of, to me, the sort of recreation of how the film got made. And, you know, I went out there thinking I wanted to shoot something at the ghost town, and I thought I was going to shoot something about, like, reenactors. And I ended up talking to him for a long time in that space before I went there, and then he showed up there the next day, sort of mysteriously, and...
I liked you. Wasn't mysterious at all.
Or he wanted a cameo, I don't know.
Yeah, there you go. Who's the red hair?
He got the role.
But, so, anyway, I got to know him through walking through the space, and so to me it was sort of about that collision of his experience of coming there, and my curiosity about this silver mining town history, and, you know, history of the West, and, you know, immigrating to that landscape for work. And that being the sort of new version, I didn't feel like that was necessary.
Hi. Wonderful. I just had a question for Ren, and I was wondering if you could tell us what's happened since this film.
Oh, yeah. Thank you for asking that.
Story.
It is a long story.
In a brief.
Yeah, I will. I was out there for 6.5 years total. And actually, part of where she's filming, where I have the flat tire, and I was pulling everything out of my chaotic truck. As I was doing that, and she was filming, I turned around with a big, heavy, one of those food containers, and lost my balance, and I went straight down on my kneecap, and I broke my kneecap. And Bridge shut the camera off and came running over there. And I kept, every time I have a disabled leg, motorcycle crash when I was young and dumb. And so when I get tired, my toe drops, and I kept falling. And this was happening more frequently. And every time I do it, I tear my shoulders. And eventually I just got thinking, you know, I got to do something about this. So I found a little house for rent out in Yermo, little 1920s little Pueblo cabin thing, and so I rented it, and I live out there now. I've been out there for 2 years now, and I still love the desert, and yeah, you know, I was glad to stay out there, but anyway, that's what I've been doing, and I'm writing a book and doing some stuff, you know, like that, so that's, yeah. But it was just getting harder and harder. The coldest I ever saw it out there was 3 degrees above zero. And the hottest I ever saw it was 128. And I was out there in it, you know, with whatever shelter I could make, or, you know. So it was just getting much harder to live like that. And I loved the freedom. I loved doing it. I'd always wanted to do it, follow the elk up the mountain and down, you know, back down. I'd said that ever since I was young. But it was scary. When my aunt or my cousin asked me to go, I was real scared, because I thought, where am I going to go? What am I going to do? But yeah, I just realized I wasn't going to die, and I figured if I could live and survive in the Mojave, I could survive anywhere. So I went out and just did what my heart had longed to do, and just people would say, where did you stay? What do you do? And I said, wherever I land that night. And I always tried to be really careful, of especially human surroundings. I was welcoming the wild animals and cougars, and a lot of things came, direct interaction with them. Not bad. I mean, all really good things. But it was hard to live like that. So I just decided that I was getting old and it was time to cash it in. Go back to some sort of conventional lifestyle. Yeah. So.
What does it mean for you to be a geologist?
Oh. I wanted to come back to your question about time, Adam.
Please.
Bridget was planning to meet me out there one time, and we were going to meet out at the Mojave Preserve out there, and she said, well, how far is it? And I looked at her, and I said, I don't know. And I really couldn't tell her in time or space how far it was. And she started to laugh at me, and she said, you can't tell me how far it is out there, but you can tell me the age of every rock and every mountain range out here. And I think, for me, part of my escape is I just put my head 600 million years in the past, and I walk away. And I really have a sense of immersing myself in what those environments were like and the creatures that were there, and it's an interesting thing. So, yeah, time, when I was laying in the San Andreas Fault there, part of that conversation with Bridget is talking about the rocks that were just above us up there that were 1.7 billion years old that are part of the San Gabriels up here. You know, so it's a different relationship to time, and I've always coming apart, it seems, here. Ever since I was a little girl, I've been picking up rocks and putting them in my pockets, and my mom used to try and wash my clothes, and she'd hear them clunking in the dryer, curse me out, because you'd forget to check my pockets. So I've always had that relationship, you know, with the rocks, and the academics was just one way of looking at it, and one part of it, and so I've always had that relationship. When I was a little girl, you heard some of this. I had a pretty rough go when I was a kid, and where I would go is climb up the mountains. We lived real close to the mountains, and I'd wedge myself in the warm rocks there, tight as I could wedge myself in there, and that was my place to be held and cry, my safe place to cry. So the rocks were literally my mother, in some ways more than my biological mother. And I just always had that sense of being able to go there and feel home and feel safe and nurtured and protected there, you know, by the rocks themselves. So it's always been an important part for me, Adam. And this relationship to time is, people talk about my warping time. Maybe I do. I get talking and 3 hours have gone by and everybody says, how did that happen? So maybe I do warp time and space. I don't know.
Set your clocks.
Yeah. You ask for a short answer. I can't do that. It's all about time. Yeah. In relationship to time. Going once, going twice.
Let's see. No, I had one more.
Oh, Adam's sure. On it. Yeah.
Well, I have one throwaway question, which is, what were the rubber ducks in that
one
shot?
What was that? I wanted to know that, too.
Well, that whole event is around, it's called Castaic Days. And so the recent, you know, events that you can go to at Castaic Days are like a rubber duck race or the girls doing dance routines. But in, like, 1992, you know, they had Kurt Cobain singing like Lead Belly at Castaic Days. So no longer on so many levels. But.
And then let's see if there's an Anders. I don't know. Maybe it is a decent time to hold off. If anybody else has any last thoughts on the things. Well, what's the project you're near? Or do you wish to talk about that at all? Which one, what you're, the new one you're in completion on? Is it also looking at the desert?
It's not quite in completion. It is another, yes, another desert that I'm working on with my friend Elizabeth Canapa. We're still kind of figuring out the structure of, but that's about this place called Cocoa Reef and the sort of gold fever leading to this story of a treasure legend of this underground river of gold that's 3,000 feet below ground. And so we're kind of tracing that idea of this cave and gold and Spanish markings and the gold magnetism to land use.
Besides, it's a good excuse to come out and see me. That's why I had to stay out there. She needed a base of operations. So.
Again, it's good. Generous world out in the desert. Any other last questions as well? Or shall we, you can continue one-on-one.
Yeah, if anyone wants to join us at the bar, I think, what did we say? What was the?
Did we decide?
What's the noisy one?
Borders? Or the other one, the powerhouse.
The powerhouse. Is anyone hungry? No one needs to eat, right? Yeah.
If we adjourn to the powerhouse, it's on Highlands, it's just north of Hollywood. So once again, please join me in thanking Ren and Bridget.